6 minutes to give their PowerPoint presentation and educate you on the product or the service they offer. And then it's time for you afterwards. There's a 20-minute Q&A for you as the audience to give suggestions of different ways they could help grow their company or just any constructive feedback that you have for them. So please be nice when doing that as well. But it's a great event and we're glad to have you all here. So we have our first presenter up this morning is Sherry with Little Light of Mine. So please give her a warm round of applause.
Complimentary photography services to children and their families living with children who have life-threatening illness. I started the organization about 18 months ago. It was just going to be a small little volunteer project that I was going to do solo. I had set aside about 4 hours a month to do the project. Little did I know how many children were actually in this position of fighting for their life and these families that were in need of these photographs. I did not realize the demand, and once I started working with All Children's Hospital and Children's Dream Fund, our two major sources of referrals, I realized that I could not get any more hours a month that I had set aside. So since then, it has grown to be a nonprofit organization or an official 501c3. Are still scaling up as we speak. So yes, we get the referrals from All Children's Hospital, Children's Dream Fund, which is like Make-A-Wish except it's local. And we are really only reaching about 1% of the families in the Tampa Bay area that are in this position of, you know, needing these services, these photography services. So we are just scratching the surface. I right now currently cover one half of one floor at All Children's Hospital on a regular basis. We have not even touched the oncology ward or any of those other floors. And we are not really promoting to get a lot of other families at this time because we need to build our team up first and grow the organization so that we can handle the demand as it happens. We have a waiting list right now. And so we need to beef up our side of the organization. So in part of this is building a team of qualified developers and then a system to match up families with our photographers on our team. So those are some very big obstacles in growing our organization. We might be able to utilize a custom app for matching up our services to families as it grows. And we have already been asked from different cities to come to other places and start our organization, mostly from families that are flown in from other places that use resources. All right, we've already done that. Collecting and organizing referrals. And yes, we're writing not on this. Okay, next. Financial considerations. Our services are provided to families at no cost without the regard to their own financial needs. So one of the things about our services is that these families who are in this situation, sometimes they're in end-of-life situations, are financially depleted because of quitting their jobs and being with their child full-time in hospital. And having professional photography services is not on their radar. So the hospital actually sends them out, you know, the offering, and many of the families are extremely grateful to take advantage of our services. It does cost about $150 to $200 per hour, to do the photographs. That's what we're averaging, and that will grow as we continue to grow and our expenses grow. Our referral sources, like we mentioned, the Children's Dream Fund, Ronald McDonald House, Hospice, our pediatric hospice group of Pinellas County, and All Children's Hospital. Go, okay. It's gonna be the last question anyhow. Should I just go? Okay. So how can the community help? Immediate need for a physical location for a studio space is a very, very important need that we have. Currently, a lot of photography is done at a bedside of in the hospital. There are a lot of children who have terminal illness that are not hospitalized and are outpatient. Some of them are fine. We meet at parks and we just have a play date, just like a normal portrait session. However, some of them have physical limitations. They can't go to the park, they can't be in the exposed in the sun, they can't overheat. Some can do the Florida, so you know, even during for healthy kids, it's not very comfortable for a family to be outside in July doing a park session. So we do need a studio space that we can invite people in regardless of weather, rain, and physical limitations. You know, a lot of them have oxygen machines all in tow, so a park setting is not ideal. So we are looking for a place to set up camp and do our photo shoots. We are also hosting an event on Thursday, November 19th at Nova 535, where you guys signed in. If you haven't already collected the two pieces, please do. There's an invite to the event, and there's also just a general flyer about our services. And we are also looking for fundraising partners in the community. Fundraising is a big deal. And volunteers for our event, volunteers for, we need photographers, people who know about fundraising, who know how to do events. I'm a photographer doing all these things, and we would have other people that are experts in those fields to do those things for us. We are also looking to build our board, or a board that needs more and more members. So, that's it.
No. aligning yourself with like a children's hospital and have them sponsor you, and then you in return give good positive feedback on what they're doing in the community. I mean, that's good to have passion for the hospital.
So we are very, very under the umbrella of All Children's Hospital. As far as partnering and having them sponsor us, we are looking at that, because All Children's Hospital is a nonprofit organization. I don't know how that all works. Again, that would be something that really, if somebody already knew those, that, you know, way to navigate, that would be awesome. You know, All Children's Hospital is a very huge organization, and it's been pretty much a small miracle that I even was able to get in and meet the right people at the right time and have this be under their umbrella. Getting money from them, I have no idea how to do that, to be honest with you. It's a good idea, and we have it on our list of things that we want to explore.
Cool. I just have a suggestion for volunteers. The high school, they have all social clubs, and they, they participate, so they gain an hour. So, especially the same thing, high, Homestead, they have like five, maybe more, like 20 social clubs. So they will definitely help you get some volunteers for service hours. All right, the high school kids need service hours.
Excellent, thank you, that's a great suggestion. Yes?
I'm piggybacking on that. I know you probably want seasoned qualified pastors, so it would be too much of a risk to maybe go to universities. There's some talented students that might do it for free to build a portfolio or experience.
There's some wonderful young photographers out there that are very talented. We have a application process for photographers, and it doesn't matter if you have a business or not, or you're 20 or 60. There's an application process everybody has to go through to send us images. It is critical. I had one case early on where I didn't have that application process, and I had a photographer, and I was desperate, so I'm like, yes, you're in. You want to do it, you're in. That's a qualification. And he went and did a shoot at All Children's, and when I got the photos, I was not pleased with them. Everybody needs to have the same, whether you get me or somebody else, as if you're a photographer, every family needs to get the same stuff. Well, I would call the hospital to reshoot it and pay big cast. So that's when we were like, okay, so we need to qualify for photographers. And we have a wide range. I've been on at the hospital photographing during disconnected life support while the child passed over there for 6 hours, while the family requests and the whole baby documented. And, so that's a very critical thing. I'll probably be the only one that handles that for a while. But we have park sessions, so a little less senior photographers would be perfectly matched for, a park session where it's really no different than a healthy child.
The resource management is a bit of a problem, because the photography, while a very important facet, is not what makes the photography table do this job.
Yeah, there's also the emotional part of it, and being able to stay composed, and that's not even the right, because I cry, so.
You got to understand, you're going to be spending a lot of time with people and life with the children, and then come back to you again tomorrow, and come back to you the next day. So that's a special type of person, and this is why you kind of quiet, because the last thing you want to do is put another sick kid on a waiting list. So we're trying to ease out. We really need to staff up and get the resources before we can actually say, hey, we're here.
But like I said, I mean, we do have a need for the, less urgent cases. There's a wide range.
Yes. Do you get your contact information of the family that you take pictures of?
Yes.
Okay. Just one thought is, I know you don't want to target them at all for money, but, they have a network of people that want to help them and can't really do anything. It's just about giving those families postcards that they could then send out to their families that can come back and sponsor some other child.
That's
what Little Life Might did for us. If you're interested in helping and sponsoring another family.
That's a really good idea, because with the fundraiser, I've had to go back and ask some families to come and speak. And I was very nervous because some children passed, and it's a sensitive situation, and I don't want them to feel like I want to exploit them. But they all have been like, totally up. I have more families to speak than I have time for them to speak at the event. It's going to be wonderful. It's going to be wonderful. But yeah, they are all very eager to help the organization because those photographs, some of them, that's all they have left now. And so they want that service for other people in their positions. So that's a really, really great suggestion. Thank you. Yes?
A few things. One, I'm in this room almost every week. I think the quietness in this room, I think, is a little bit out of, this is incredible. And nobody said that yet, so I just want to thank you for filling this obvious need. Jumping on a couple, what Danielle was just saying, somebody help me here. There's a website that I've had a couple families go through this, that families join, that gives a central place for people to go to updates. Then we know what site I'm talking about.
Caring Bridge.
So that would seem like a place for you to, right? That's what Danielle was saying. If you could get to Caring Bridge and say, right, you could help.
Our goal is to have a connection like that for families on our website. By the way, we need a website too. That is what part of the website, part of our vision. And not only that, but to have picnics where we invite all of our families back and get to know each other because they do bond, you know. Having a situation like that with another parent, you're friends for life. And so we want to bring those families together, support them. So it is the photography, you know, that's what we do. But we also support those families and, you know, build a community that they can all like lift them and love them through this whole experience together.
I might have a recommendation on a web developer. Where's JJ? Here somewhere. What I'm thinking about is that you asked about streamlining and you need a system. It seems like the system Venue Viking built has a lot of perhaps are you in the room? So maybe you guys, because your developers are all so low, I'm just thinking maybe you can connect later.
Yeah, of course.
All right, see what I'm thinking. So there's, talk to him about the system he built, perhaps repurpose it. I need more coffee.
Heart transplant in the world. So when those families are here and they use our services, quite often you will be asked, I've already been asked several times to expand and come and do it at their, you know, teach them how to do it at their hospital. Like, we don't even know what we're doing here, so. But yes, the goal would be, you know, to expand and provide this service.
We need to create a recreatable process that we expand, but we're still developing that. I mean, she handled 84 individual families last year, and it wasn't even half of one floor at all children's. I mean, the demand is just so astronomical. Is this y'all's full-time job? It could well easily be.
It is a job that has no paycheck quite yet. Yeah. It's a full-time volunteer position.
Hey, I'm going to this class next week. It's Eric, his name's Eric Smith. He does this Facebook thing where he connects Facebook and your web page and all the little things that are on the internet connects it together into a class. I don't know that much about it yet, but I know he turns it into a funnel, and it funnels what you want, like a photographer, a donator, people that maybe need your service. And I'm going to get the information in the next 3 weeks. I'll have all of it, but his name's Eric Smith, if you want his number.
I would love that, yeah. Thank you. Yes.
Just an idea in terms of looking at your model and then potentially pulling in for photographers. It's an organization. It started and it has grown across the U.S. called the Heart Gallery.
Yeah, I used to be on Dallas.
I photographed for them before I did that. That's a great network of photographers who understand the emotional aspect of it and have signed on. But then their model has grown to where they've got different counties, different states, and it could be.
Yeah, and I know all those guys over there. I did that for several years before I did mine. So thank you.
Yeah. So what's the application criteria for photographs?
They have to fill out just basic information, but then submit 20 images and just 20 of your, and, you know, we suggest low-level lighting. The hospital room is all fluorescent lighting. We do not like to use strobes in the hospital rooms. So you have to, you know, have a camera that can handle, you know, have a pretty good ISO and be able to do low-level lighting. And then we have a panel of people that will look at their work and determine whether they're qualified.
Because I was thinking that you're going to need the right people for this, the photographers, as you were explaining, the emotional side of the whole model. But what is the family's abilities to, like, maybe do it themselves? Is there any way that you can standardize the process, or maybe they can take pictures that are up to the level of photographers, and that way you, like, put that side out?
The families themselves?
Yeah, because like you said how like they left their jobs, something like that. Maybe there's a way you, the organization can have them develop time to maybe develop those skills and have them do it themselves and become a workforce. Who knows?
Just so emotionally tied up.
Yeah, that's kind of the last thing I would even want to do is encourage and try to train them. I mean, it's a service to take them off their plate. So I mean, it's often they aren't even thinking about having us come and do it, much less them do it. I mean, everybody's got cell phone pictures. Everybody's got a billion cell phone pictures of their kid in the hospital or whatever, you know, wherever their child is. But what we do is professional, like, you know, portrait services, high resolution. They can be blown up to billboard size if they so wish. They can distribute them, so they're not just little cell phone pics that are grainy and not necessarily composed right with the first season's photographer. So, and I can't create a seasoned photographer by training a grieving parent or, you know, in any kind of capacity that I don't know.
But that's actually a really good point that I was bringing up, that off of that, I find this a lot, is the, how shall we say, ubiquity of cameras makes everybody think that there's an ubiquity of photographers. And there is a huge difference that a professional photographer brings something. This is not something you can just give them a bullet point PowerPoint lesson, now they're a professional photographer. And that's one of the big hurdles, actually, of making people understand what that added level really means. Because people have, the photographers are everywhere, Facebook is everywhere. So what's the difference between a professional? It is huge. It is amazing. So communicating that has become a real challenge for our organization.
So I want to have wedding pictures done, or I want to have portraits, or whatever it happens to be. So I go on and I punch in photographers in St. Petersburg, and I get a listing of 10 different women. I'm like, okay, so what's what? What's really the difference here? It seems to me that what you're doing here is you're creating sort of an offering that photographers can provide in your website or whatever. If you have, you know, your gallery of pictures, and then you have connections to those people, and you have something that you can really help them promote themselves in the jobs that they do, that would be beneficial in some way. Because I know for myself, I wouldn't know, unless I knew somebody personally, I have no idea which one of those 10 people I would deal with. But if I saw somebody who was doing something that I thought was really important and I felt good about it, then that's personal opinion.
Yes, we've thought about that, yes, certifications, and also just, you know, allowing them to, us to endorse their photography skills. Honestly, out of the, let's say out of 10 photography applications we get, I would say 3 get improved.
It's turned out to be a way lower than that.
So we have to wrap, final question, me?
Well, you said me.
Oh, I picked somebody.
No. Your final question is, beyond needing help with your web development, what again can the community do?
We will see you all Thursday, November 19th. If you have any restaurants, we are still looking to fill some food tasting spots, volunteers, and it's 6:30 to 9:30 at Nova 535. And you can contact me through the material, you know, the materials that are on the table back there. So thank you very much.
So normally I'm up here to tell you about all the fun events going on, but all of these will be linked for you in our email at the end of the week. If you're not signed up for that email, we only send 2 a week, one to tell you who's presenting, and then one to follow up and recap the presenters and how you as a community can help. So all of that information is over there. I'm up here to ask you guys for some help. So as an organizer, our hardest problem are finding people who want to present. Every week, 2 people consistently, we run out of, you know, places to find those people. So we're up here asking you guys as a community if you can help us get the word out about the presenters. It's completely free to present. If you want to present, it's not like we line you up next week. You can book, you know, 6+ weeks out if you want to. But also, once you present here in St. Pete, you have the option to present at any other 1 million cups. So there's 74 different locations. There's 7 alone in the state of Florida. So it's a very good way for you to quickly get involved with the other entrepreneurial communities in those prospective cities. So again, if you guys know anyone, to give you a little criteria, we take anyone from a concept stage all the way up to 4 years in business. And you have to have a unique and, most importantly, a scalable business model. So if you have any questions of whether or not your company is right to present or your friend's is, please come see us. We're happy to explain and find out a little bit more about those businesses. We do have Station House over here that has an event coming up real quick. If you want to talk about it?
Yeah, so hi, I'm Michael, founder of Venue Viking. I also had a unique opportunity to work with the Station House. How many people have heard of Station House? The restaurant downtown? All right, well, it's actually a 5-story renovated building. The bottom stairs of the restaurant. So we're opening the upper levels to a co-work social club. It's going to be a networking mecca. We partnered with T-Bella and Cabo Coffee. They're going to be in there. But we're having our grand opening next Thursday. So if you can make it out, it's at 5:30.
And we'll also send you our email at the end of the week. We'll link to that event also. But if you have any other questions, I'm sure you'd be happy.
Yeah, I have some flyers back here. I have cards. Steve's here as well. He can help answer any questions. So come see us after this.
Awesome, thanks. And then you also have, if you guys haven't noticed, we have Iron Yard in the house here. They are a development boot camp, is the best way to phrase it, right down the street. And on the 13th, they have their demo day. So all of these students have been working on fun applications throughout the past couple weeks, and this is their opportunity to present it in front of a crowd. Similar type, you know, event or atmosphere to 1 Million Cups, but a great great opportunity to get involved with them. So if you have any questions, they can answer right here. We'll also link you some information at the end of the week. And then also one quick thing to highlight is the Quest for the Emerald Paw. That is a scavenger hunt that's going to benefit Friends of Strays on the 14th. It's a fun event that's going to start the Friends of Strays shelter, and then meander your way through downtown St. Pete and stop at all different fun types of local businesses with all different activities. So if you have any questions on it, it'll be linked and I'm happy to answer. But also, if you have any interest in volunteering for the event, we do need a lot of volunteers. So anyone who wants community service hours or, you know, any other way to give back, we'd love to have you just for a couple hours to help. But again, all that information will be in the email. So I will get out of your way, and please give a warm round of applause to Mark with ReSell Solutions.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Mark Embry, and I'm the founder of ReSell Solutions. We are a software consolidation firm. We took a variety of business applications that were being used by small, medium-sized businesses and took the concepts and repackaged them, reprogrammed them, and placed them into a single application and made it a cloud application inside of Microsoft's Azure cloud platform. We continue to add new concepts, new programs into this platform as we go along and as we obtain new customers. So in order to find the problem that our solution attacks, we have to take a look at what all these applications are. The business are using email, generally email for marketing, and then they use some type of QuickBooks, accounting, and inventory solutions. They use Ads for Sales, and they use Excel for inventory and warranty returns and other items within their business processes. Then they generally use GoDaddy or some tool like WordPress for their websites. So what is the exact problem that we attack? Well, in short, it's communication or the lack thereof. Small business applications generally attack a single problem within a business, and they're not designed to talk to each other. So we set about and attack that specific problem so that we could have a product that everything inside that business talk to each other. So the goals of this solution was it had to be customer focused. It had to be affordable. It had to consolidate these diverse applications as well as build a platform where we could continue to add these applications into the product. And it had to be scalable. As the company grew, we had to make it where they didn't have to change software platforms and applications just in order to house the growth of the business. So we started at the customer level, build a module around the customer, and then we added a customer relationship management tool around them. And then we added sales and sales automation tool, workflows, etc. And the byproduct of all those sales automation tools was the invoicing to the customer. Then we added a marketing platform that allowed drip email marketing, email blast campaigns, as well as customized templates that were interacting with both the sales rep and the customer. Then we added a platform where we could import leads into the system and manage those leads without the sales reps having to get involved so they can stay on the phone in building the business. Then we went in out to the warehouse and added inventory control and warehouse management tools. We added warranty subsystems to handle returns, and then return to vendors, as well as advanced replacements. We then moved the software to Microsoft Azure platform, not just spinning up a virtual server, but we actually reprogrammed things so it was set on their software as a service platform. We then added a website module that our customers can get into and actually have their products interact, their website interact with their actual live database and be updated real time. We added a CMS, a content management module to that platform, as well as an e-commerce module so they can take orders straight over their website. One of the objects of the plan was to get these small businesses into a enterprise level platform at the lowest cost possible. And so I think zero is a pretty good price, but we ended up giving away the first month of services free of charge. So customers have a chance to get into the application, use the application. Also, they don't have to spend any money on a local network, any money on paying people to manage that network, or to maintain the software on that network. So there's zero cost for these small, medium-sized businesses to get into this application. We have four streams of revenue: our software as a service, our custom programming to our larger accounts, we sell training services, and we are now Microsoft BizPort customer, and we can offer cloud Azure services such as Office 365 online and SharePoint online. And that's the presentation. We work out of Tampa Bay Wave in their co-working facility, and so we get involved in a few things, and there are a lot of good young programmers over there that contact me and pass up. So that's the presentation. Open up the floor for any questions.
I was on your website last night.
Yes, sir.
And maybe it's there, maybe I didn't see it. But do you have any training tutorials on
Yeah, I took it to the education tab.
Okay. Yeah. Because there was a previous company I was affiliated with. We went with a point of sale software simply because they had a ton of tutorials that made it look super easy to use. Now, I would assume that if you're integrating all these different applications together, it would be a little complicated. So, yeah, I was wondering if you had, you know, what's a really easy
Yeah, I think there is 20 or 30 fairly linked. I've been asked to cut them down into pieces so that people don't get too bored with them. But most of the major modules out there, up until about the last 6 months, they have a video pertaining to them. And also, we didn't just integrate. We integrated with a few of the applications, such as QuickBooks. We built an interface there, and a few of the things are actually interfaces to. But more than that, we took the concepts that the small businesses were using out of these diverse applications and actually reprogrammed them to fit within our model. Yes,
ma'am. Where are you with the software being built, and what languages did you use?
It's been in production for a year now, and it's built on Microsoft's .NET stack. We have both C# and VB.NET. From a back end, we use SQL and database. Well, that's Azure SQL now. Yes, sir.
A little bit on branding. I see ReSell a lot. Did you have a name for this platform?
Well, I don't have a separate name for it. This is a huge market, but we're attacking the IT resellers right now, and so we're going to stay focused on the resellers for several other verticals, and so. Yes, the name ReSell.
So I was wondering, because it seemed very specific.
Very specific.
Your product was very generic. You know,
yeah, and we attack a lot of issues that the big boys don't play in, and by that, it really lends itself to that ReSell vertical, which is what we stick with that. Yes, sir.
Another question. As a potential customer for this, Do you have any demos that I could play with and see if, how it works?
Yeah, we have a live demo that if you just email me, and I've got a card over there, get you, email me in a request for a login, and I'll set you up a login, and that system is live online. Now, I have to warn you that a lot of companies are demoing the software. I just got back from a trade show, but I'll set you up one personally, and you can walk through the data. There's really no telling what data is out here right now, but you're free to use it. Yes, sir.
Is this something that can be used like for mining companies, somebody that's in mining business?
It really depends on what your relationship, how many diverse customers are you dealing with as far as you're trying to sell to. If you're actively selling to, you know, you're picking up, some sales rep is picking up the phone, making phone calls, or visiting these guys, and you want the ability to interact that with your inventory or whatever goods you are reselling, then this will work with that. Yes, sir.
So is your customer the IT reseller or the small business owner looking for the services?
It's the IT reseller that's looking to grow his business. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Can this operation be used for government, you know, say if they have an IT business, but they're government-oriented, they have contracts with the government, and that's something they can use?
Well, it really depends on how that interaction, if they're interacting with a lot of different people within the government, it's a very nice tool. It's probably an overkill from email template, email blasts, and things like that, but it doesn't have to be used. But it's a very good product to manage that those contacts and those touches with those contacts, and then interacts with the invoicing, anything you're reselling to the government. We did a proposal for a company in Bradenton recently that was selling to different military installations across the country, and there might be 10 or 15 people at each installation that they were dealing with, and this was working very nicely.
Good. Mark, can you re-summarize a little bit of an elevator pitch to clarify that your target customer is the IT reseller? So can you kind of rephrase, IT resellers have this particular problem before we came along, there wasn't a solution. So here's a specific problem IT resellers have. Here's what Reseller Solutions does. Here's how we make money on it. Let's just clarify a little bit.
Let me go back to the beginning here. And every small IT reseller that I've walked into in the last 5 years, these were the tools they were using. And the big problem here, as I say a while ago, is the communication between these objects. Okay, you've got the sales rep that's sitting there talking to the customer, putting his notes into act, and then he turns around and sells something because he looked up, he went over here to his Excel spreadsheet that was housing his inventory levels and sold a product to the customer. And this is the biggest problem they run into, is that the warehouse, the shipping guy who shipped the last product out the door didn't bother updating that Excel spreadsheet that previous day. And so when they have that Excel spreadsheet in front of them selling that product, they no longer have that product to sell. So they have to get back on the phone and try to downsell another product that that customer doesn't want. That is the biggest problem that we overcome with the real-time inventory and CRM solution. Yes, sir. I'm sorry. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, just I guess one follow-up. Is your business then to integrate all these tools or replace these tools with a single tool that does all the
things? With the exception of QuickBooks, okay, I didn't try to write an accounting solution. What I did was take the tools from QuickBooks and integrate from an accounting perspective. But QuickBooks used to do a real bad job of inventory management. So we wrote, our product replaces that out of QuickBooks and then hands over the finished purchase order to finish sales order into QuickBooks and lets it do its accounting, manage the cash and all those things. So we don't try to do that. So in that perspective, we interface with that product. Well, we're working on an interface today with eBay and Amazon. And because a lot of the small sites sell off of that, we want to make that process easier. But for the most part, all the other parts we rewrote and repackaged into that solution.
Okay. Yeah, would this system that you got work for a company that doesn't necessarily sell software, but maybe they sell supplements or something?
Oh, if you're selling a product or a service, this solution will fit your needs. It may be overkill in given areas, but it'll fit.
I see a big business in the furniture store business, because they have so many locations, so many salespeople, and they go in and they upload the inventory, and they need it in real time. And one of the worst things a customer hates is he finds out that everything is sold, or he's only in half the bedroom set, had to right. set some. I think maybe this will solve that solution for them.
Maybe I haven't approached that market.
Yeah.
I checked into a little bit of the office furniture stuff, but
furniture stores.
Furniture stores.
It's also just a kind of lead off of what Chris was asking. So it is replacing most of those tools, except it's interfacing with the QuickBooks. So is your software called ReSell Solutions, or is that just
The software is ReSell Solutions as well as the company.
So when the customer goes and logs in, they'll be logging into ReSell Solutions software.
That's correct.
What if small business isn't using QuickBooks? They're using some other kind of accounting software.
Well, I attacked QuickBooks because about 95% of the small businesses and startups are using QuickBooks. It took me a couple of weeks to write that interface, but if I have a request for additional, like right now, I'm working with Sage Accounting to get the approval to start writing that interface. So if I have a request and that request comes from a valid customer, then I'll attack that interface. Yeah. I saw it. Yes, sir.
Do you sell or lease? ReSell, and what is the price point?
The price point, got a slide on that. it's going to take a while to get there. We have three tier pricing, okay? We have the intro model for the really small businesses, less than 5 users. It's $100 a month for all the users, for everything, okay? Then that price is good for 6 months. By 6 months, they'll know whether they can outgrow that solution. And then we move them to a per user per price, and the price point is $59 per user per month for everything that we use in that year. And then over 200 users, then we'll start giving it a volume discount per user per month. We've been approached by a fairly large worldwide customer to sell it for one price fee, but most small businesses can't afford that fee. So. Yes, ma'am.
Just as a quick comment, I have to say, I know a company that uses this software, and I have friends that are salespeople at this using it from a day-to-day standpoint, and it brings so much efficiency to that salesperson because they're not having to go in all different areas to update, you know, the CRM, the Excel spreadsheets, the accounting. So it is a very efficient solution that helps a salesperson, you know, very much so on the floor in their day-to-day operations.
It actually got a friend of mine fired from his job. His 1099 was larger than that of his CEO's, and they had a big fight about it over the weekend, and the Monday morning back to work, he was no longer. But he started his own firm, it's doing very well. He used my product too. And the nice thing about it, modern enterprise, like a local firm, uses it. They have over 200 employees around the country and around the world now. But it's efficient enough to run a startup, okay? And it's not so overburdened with data entry because you're only entering that data one time. And since everything is all tied together, you don't have to go here or here or here to look for that information. Yes, sir.
So who is your main competition? And sort of what are your key differentiators? Maybe I missed that.
No, it takes me 6 minutes to get through the first part of it. So, the main competition, the big daddy in the room is Salesforce.com. They're the old IBM name. You can't go wrong if you use the biggest. The second biggest is Microsoft. Even though we're a partner, they don't play in all the small verticals that we get involved with. And in fact, I wrote Bology's original CRM ERP solution, and Microsoft has been inside their solution 3 different times trying to replace that functionality and still can't. So, but they are the second larger player. The differentiation between us and Salesforce is Salesforce's main product is a CRM product, where ours is a complete enterprise level. Now, you can get there with Salesforce, but you have to purchase all these add-ons along with the original package. And if you compare Salesforce's price to our price, Salesforce's, with all their add-ons, is about $250 per month per user to get the same functionality that we offer for $59. And Microsoft's, the difference between them and us, as I said, the verticals that they can't participate in, but also they depend upon partners to sell their product, and they have 3 main products. And when I was with Bology, it took $1.5 million to communicate from their CRM module down into their accounting module. So unless you got a big pocketbook, the small guy cannot participate in that product, or it's very tough. I put NetSuite up here. They're probably the closest, largest competitor that does the same thing we do, but they sell it by the individual modules, so they start at our price range, and then they add on as they go along. They lost a ton of money last year because the software rollouts were just horrendous. People, their customer base just went through with that.
For an IT reseller, you're basically providing the whole product.
I'm providing nuts to bolts, everything in between. The only thing I'm not providing is when we hand it off to the accounting solution. And it's as easy as pushing a button to push that data through. Now, yes, sir.
So it seems like a really neat product, very useful, got a good testimonial, and you've been out for a year now. What do you think it's going to take to start seeing exponential growth? What's stopping you from, you have all the right base in place from really growing this thing?
Well, the main thing that's stopping me right now is I'm not a salesperson. I coded this. And so I'm in the process of looking for the right partner as a sales, the sales into this. I've got the guys that I contract with, both locally and overseas, to actually assist with the maintenance of the product. I've got that covered. Now I'm looking to take the next step and do and get that partner on board that can handle the day-to-day sales and build up a support staff. That's probably the largest drawback I have as a small business is what happens if you get hit by a Mack truck on the way home tonight. And I make an agreement with my customers. I put my software in escrow for those customers in the event something happens to me. It was programmed in a straight Microsoft.net platform, so any 5-year programmer could come in, take over the product, and do that. Yeah. Yes, sir?
I think this product might be good for tech data. I mean, it's a local company. They're here in Clearwater.
Now, they have a very extensive in-house solution. I know one of the vice presidents over there, but which is probably more than Salesforce, is probably my biggest competition, our in-house programmers. We've got about 7 to 8 man years of programming into this product, and so do most larger IT organizations. And so that is, from a larger customer base, that is probably my largest competition.
Would you be considering looking for funding to get that?
Yeah, that's one of the things that I'm here to look for, is if there are any investment opportunities that somebody would like to approach me with, we could set them up. Sure. Okay, sir.
Yeah, I would say as a custom developer, this is exactly the systems I've developed for 2 decades now, is integrating those things. So this is, we know that this is where everything's going, pulling it up to the cloud. That's great. I like the fact that you're focused on one niche, because that's what's going to make you successful. My recommendation is to stop thinking sales and start thinking marketing, because sales is not going to be the problem. It's getting the word out in a vital type of way, which means getting out there when a small business is searching for CRM solutions, searching for integration with accounting solutions, searching for inventory. So I think like Symphony downtown, there are so many people who can start managing that buying cycle, that automated cycle you mentioned in one of your slides, for you would be, because there's a lot of IT resellers out there, very small. You can't really do it on a direct sales basis. You'll lose your shirt. So you need to have them come to you in a more interactive way. So I think looking at that electronic marketing, if you branded your focus, you're really set up for that, and a good AdWords campaign. Because this is something that can be national.
Even to piggyback off of his comment, something like this CRM, the channel company that has those access to those reseller networks, the tech data is they have their different groups, they could potentially be a great partner in terms of touching and reaching them through their exchange events and their online. They have their reseller base is massive. And I know that some of them do custom programs, and you could potentially be one of their partners to the custom program.
Go left to the big dog, go left to the chat as well.
Yeah.
Here's a question.
Yes.
Final question.
Okay.
What can the community do to help you?
Well, obviously, bringing new customers to the table is something that is always appreciated. Something I mentioned a minute ago is bringing on a partner, because it's pretty lonely at the time, especially if you have to wear all the hats. But I'm a programmer by trade, and so it's tough. I mean, when somebody asks me what time it is, I tell them how I built the watch. And so. But having somebody else there to either do marketing, to do the sales, I'm looking to bring a partner on like that is really for investment, so I can go hire that upper level person.
Okay. Great Daggers, huge attendance today. Around here about 75 people. Once again, we're one of the largest 1 million cups communities nationwide. And that's because you go home and you tell your friends, hey, I went to this awesome 1 million cups thing this morning. You get free coffee, and it's every Wednesday morning, and you see a great presenter. So the one thing I'm asking is tell somebody today that you were here. This is awesome. And then remember the 19th. The 19th is the little outline event, so don't forget about that. Because we have such a big group here, and let me just take a second. I haven't done this before. This is my selfie stick. Do you guys care?